Hey, Hawken with Shotgun Diagnostics. Today we're going to do a diagnostic video on a 2015 Volkswagen, which actually just happens to be my own vehicle. So I'm going to walk you through something. This was an interesting diagnostic. Did not really expect it to go this way, but wanted to point out a couple of things just in terms of the process of the diagnosis, as well as some of the specific things I did to find out what was wrong with the vehicle. So anyway, I'm going to show you my setup here. Anytime I am doing any kind of diagnostics with key on engine off, I like to set up a maintainer. This one is the Tornado T30,000 from TOPDON. Got it connected to the battery here, and this will actually output up to 30 amps to hold voltage steady and basically maintain that battery while we're doing key on engine off testing. So, really a good tool. Like to have this on anytime, like I said, I'm doing any extended testing on the vehicle for any kind of diagnosis. So anyhow, we'll go ahead and get into the diagnostic now. I'm gonna head over to the vehicle here and we'll get it connected up.
So before we go any further here, just wanted to demonstrate, did do a preliminary scan on the vehicle. There were no faults in any modules of any kind. So you can see we got green on the screen here on all modules. Excuse me, that are talking, so we know there's no fault codes. The other thing I wanted to illustrate before we launch into the remainder of this is the normal operation. So normal operation, you will see this kind of a speedometer style icon on the dash cluster there in the center of the screen, circled with red. And then on the steering wheel, there is the similar icon, which is the cruise enable switch. So basically telling the vehicle, yes, I would like cruise available. Obviously that's not activating. You use set to activate it and set your speed. But in order to enable that functionality, you need to press that button that's circled in kind of that yellowish green color there. And that will allow cruise control to function. So, just wanted to cover that first before we launch into the remainder of this. So we're going to continue on with the discussion here just as far as we scanned the vehicle, we didn't find any codes. So where do we go from this point, right? We're trying to figure out what makes the most sense as far as the next step in the diagnostic process. So what I like to do is sketch out kind of an overall tree of possibilities. Why would cruise control potentially not be functioning? What are the different things that could be potentially broken with the car that could be causing this issue, right? So there's a lot of possibilities, but we want to basically make ourselves like a conceptual chart here that'll really help us kind of wrap our head around what can we check next, what makes the most sense. Maybe if you have information from Identifix, there might be a common issue, or if you are familiar with the brand you're working on and you know there's a known issue or common thing, that might drive your decision making as far as which one of the branches you're going to go chop off first on the tree here, right? For me, that's sometimes the case, but I work on a lot of different brands of vehicles and sometimes I'm not super familiar with common things, right? I do like to use Identifix for that exactly, because I'm not going to shotgun blast a diagnosis. I'm going to use it maybe to drive which one of these things it makes the most sense to check first. So we did verify there's no fault codes in any modules. So we're going to go ahead and we're going to chop that branch off and say, hey, we're not concerned about that. We do not believe that that's a factor here. So the next thing I went to, because it's something I can do from the driver's seat, and I firmly believe that that is a good practice, is to try and diagnose what you can from the driver's seat. And remember, there are limitations on that, but start there if you can, because you're going to get a lot of valuable information from that exercise. So we're going to go to the switches next. We're going to look at cruise control activation switch or enable switch. Does the vehicle acknowledge whether or not the switch is actually being pressed, right? We want to find that out. So I like to look up and find out, you know, how does the system work? What is it using for cruise control functionality? And also, you know, what do we have for live data? So in this particular case, Volkswagen has what they call self-study programs or SSPs. That's where I found the information on the left-hand side of the screen here. So the left-hand side of the screen shows us that we do have, I'm going to move my little person window here. The left side of the screen here, we see cruise control is basically controlled, deactivation of it is controlled by a brake switch. So brake switch F and F47. Now, this is on an older vehicle that this self-study program is from. This 2015 Jetta that we're working on employs the same switch, but it is not located in the same place. It is located actually on the master cylinder on this vehicle as opposed to on the brake pedal assembly. Now, if it's a manual transmission, we can see there's also a clutch pedal switch, which can also cancel cruise function. So basically what we're seeing here is that, hey, stopping cruise from functioning could be a function of the brake pedal switch. Then we can see over on the right-hand side, there's actually a TSB, or tech tip as they call it. It's not technically a TSB, it's Volkswagen calls them tech tips. You'll find these from time to time and they're very helpful. They'll give you kind of pieces of data that will maybe help you in a diagnosis. So in this particular circumstance, they're telling us, number one, you want to check the ECM to make sure cruise control is actually activated from a functional perspective, because you can tell an ECM this vehicle doesn't have cruise or this vehicle does have cruise. So in this particular case, that's a pretty easy check. I will show you that on the scan tool screen so you can see what that looks like. You can see they're giving us the specifics, but we're going to discuss right now the bottom section of this TSB, which is basically showing us the various input fields that the ECM will display in the scan tool. So field 2 we see under measured value block 66. Measured value blocks are just a way of displaying data that Volkswagen uses. On most vehicles now, newer stuff, you can look at either these old school measured value blocks or they have a master list of PIDs that you can pull up. So we'll show you that on the scan tool. But essentially what we got here is the upper column, the field 2 section, shows us whether or not the ECM sees the brake pedal depressed in two different PIDs, the clutch pedal depressed if applicable, and whether or not cruise control is actually activated on this ECM. And then you can see also on the far left, cruise control operation, are you someone pressing the gas and overriding that functionality of cruise in either of those two fields. So it does show you what the normal status is just below that there. Normal cruise control operating 0100100. Okay? And then gas pedal overriding 1000100. So anyway, helpful information if you're trying to troubleshoot this kind of issue. So now we go to the field 4. That's really what I was focused on at this point. I did check the other stuff and everything looked normal, but again, we cruise enable was never happening, so we couldn't verify any of this other stuff truthfully, other than is it activated on the ECM? And the answer is yes. And we could check the brake pedal depressed. Now, I want to caution you on that. Remember the scan tool data refresh speeds are a function of how fast the data network is on the car, and there's always a delay and lag. And the refresh rate is never going to be fast enough to tell you with absolute certainty that there is or is not a glitch with something like a brake pedal switch. So it's very important to remember that, because you might make a faulty judgment call on something like this if you do not use a scope. So we're going to get into that, and I'm going to demonstrate that in a little bit here. So looking at field 4, we see that cruise switch, which would be the cruise enable switch, which is what's not functioning on this car, we can see if the ECM is acknowledging that that switch is being pressed by looking at that farthest over to the right field. Then the next one over, we can see that there is a cancel button or a cruise switch turned on, basically the set button, cruise switch turned on, my mistake. 0 would be cancel button, so basically that's saying, hey, I don't want to have cruise right now. Then we go to the next field to the left, set or minus button pressed, and then the final field, resume or plus button pressed. So basically we can verify the option or the functionality of each of the switches on the steering wheel and see, okay, yes, the ECM is acknowledging each of these buttons and whether or not they are in fact being pressed. So that's important. Good scan tool diagnosis step that you can do right from the driver's seat. So we did exactly that. Now what I did do in this prior step was I did verify that switch, the cruise control enable switch, was wired directly to the ECM. I wanted to make sure that wasn't a switch where we press the button and it has to travel through several different modules as a signal to get to the ECM. I wanted to make sure of that just to make sure we weren't asking other questions here. And no, it's wired directly to the ECM, so we know that there is nothing in between preventing that signal from getting to the ECM. So we went and we looked. Okay, so this is what the fields will look like if the cruise control enable switch is switched off, or if the ECM is never acknowledging or seeing the switch position, right? If it never knows that the switch is on, it'll always read zero like this. And again, remember, it's the farthest to the right feel, or the farthest to the right digit on switch positions 2, 66-4. This is what's telling us whether or not that cruise enable switch has been depressed. So this is the way that it looks right now. Now, change fields. Now we have a 1 there. So we can see that the ECM is seeing that switch position change. It knows that we say, hey, I would like cruise enabled right now. I'm not trying to set a speed and actually use cruise, but I would like the option to activate cruise. So I'm pressing the enable button. The ECM is acknowledging it's seeing the switch position. So we know the switch is intact and functioning. We know the wiring between is intact and functioning. We know there's no connection issues or anything like that. So we've eliminated that. So now we want to figure out where do we go from here, right? Just as a display, you can see what the icon looks like. I wanted to show that as well. Move the webcam over to the right here. So if we look here, we can see the symbol on the steering wheel is like a little miniature speedometer, if you will. And then we also look up at the dash cluster, and we see there's that little speedometer type symbol displayed there also. This is what it should look like if cruise enable is active and functioning normally. In this particular case, on this vehicle, when it was faulting, we would press that cruise enable switch, nothing happened on the cluster. So it would never display the cruise enable requested on the cluster. And of course, we had no cruise functionality. But we went in and we verified with that scan tool, the ECM knows we're asking for it. The ECM acknowledges I'm pressing the switch. So why is it not showing us on the cluster? Why are we still not getting cruise control functionality? So clearly we need to go back and look at our tree and figure out what next, right? So we're going to go back and look at the tree and we're going to ask ourselves, you know, what other stuff makes sense here? What else can we kind of chop off and look at that would make sense based on our symptoms? Well, we had no drivability symptoms. We had no fault codes of any kind. So we know fault codes are off the table. We know that the switches for cruise control activation are off the table. That's working. The ECM knows it's working. We might want to ask ourselves now, is there a communication problem? Is there a module-related problem? Something of that nature. Or do we maybe have a brake light switch functionality issue that's stopping cruise from being activated, right? We have to ask ourselves that. Now, we looked at the data PIDs, and I didn't put this up on the screen, but I did look at the data PIDs for the activation of the brake light switch, and nothing was out of whack there. I didn't see anything at all that should be preventing that. I kind of asked myself, well, I'm still going to go check the brake switch because it's super common on these vehicles, and I'm skeptical that it's completely normal and everything's fine. Now, that's my paranoia. That may not have been the smartest diagnostic step. Maybe I should have chopped that off the tree and taken it off the table. Right? I will say I also checked all of the other stuff that's on the list here. Speedometer was functioning normally. There was no issues there. There was nothing related to how the vehicle captures speed, malfunctioning, no erratic behavior, nothing like that. So you can chop the speedometer aspect off or vehicle speed capturing. That was fine, normal. You can also cross off the vehicle electrical foundation, electrical system. Alternator was fine, battery passed a load test, no issues of any kind related to that. And again, network health was not something I was entertaining really at this point, just because we don't have any faults. There's no battery faults, there's no voltage faults, there's no abnormal behavior from any module of any kind other than our one symptom. So really, it doesn't make any sense to go after a network issue at this point. Now, I'm not saying you shouldn't scope the network ever or that it maybe isn't something worth checking, but again, I would expect there would be some fault codes here or at a minimum some other symptoms, right? And there are not. So we're going to proceed on and look at the brake switch next. That's what I felt would make sense. And again, it's a common failure on not only Volkswagen, Audi, but there are a lot of vehicle manufacturers that have issues with these switches. And if you think about it, it's a switch that gets cycled on and off an awful lot, right? In many cases, there is a level of mechanical force that gets applied to the switch to make it change state. It gets cycled repeatedly, and of course, electronics have a propensity to wear out, and these switches are, of course, electronic. So I felt that the switch would make sense because that's, again, a potentially wearable component and actually not uncommon on these vehicles. So we're going to go ahead and we're going to look down that avenue and see where we go from there.
Okay, we're now hooked up to the vehicle with the scope. We've got pins 1 and 3 on the vehicle connected to the scope. I chose to back pin at the brake switch, which is mounted on the master cylinder for this particular vehicle. So basically what we're going to do now is demonstrate normal operation of the brake switch. Now again, the brake switch was not the problem on this vehicle, but we'll demonstrate what a normal one looks like, at least on this application, but I believe on a lot of other vehicles they're going to work similar to this. Now you're going to notice there's basically two pins that we're watching here, and the reason for that being is, so there's two modules that can watch this. J519, the BCM, can watch this, as well as the ECM can watch this, and both modules can see one of these two pins, and the ECM can see the other pin, if I recall correctly, on the wiring diagram. Now, this is important because it's a fail-safe. So if one side of the circuit fails and one of the two sensors internal to this assembly fails, then you will end up with a fault code, and obviously the vehicle's not going to drive normal, the brake lights might not work correctly, and cruise control may be disabled. So we've got our time sweep set up to 5 seconds. You could shorten that up to 1 second if you wanted to. In fact, we'll go ahead and do that just so you can see the difference here. And then we've also got our voltage scale set to 5 volts on both channels. And we've got our sample rate, which you can control up in the menu in the top left here under user set. I always set it to maximum sample rate, which is 50/10M, which I believe is 10 million. So we're going to go ahead and hit run. It'll show stop when it's not running, and I'll just actuate the brake pedal here. So you can see when I press and hold and then let up, you can see that the switches do the opposite of each other. One goes to zero, the other one goes all the way up. So it's important to note that we could actually switch this to a 10 volt scale if we wanted to here, like this, because the switches actually go all the way up to that. So you can see we're at about 12 voltage or battery voltage on this one, and then this one goes down to zero, starts high, goes low. So they basically work opposite of each other, and this is the fail-safe protection for the ECM, for the brake control unit, everything, so it knows the proper positions of the switches. So one thing I like to do to check and see if there's any failures or any issues is I like to pump the brake pedal a bunch of times. Sometimes I'll even hit it really fast to try and jiggle the switch. And if you jiggle the switch fast enough, sometimes you might catch some abnormal behavior. Now, I'm not super worried about that, but if I do that repeatedly and get a lot of weird behavior out of it, I might be suspicious that one leg of the switch is starting to fail. Because again, you want these to mirror each other at all times. If they don't, and when I say mirror, basically opposites of each other, but if they're not, you can have issues with cruise control, the brake switch cannot function as far as the lights go, you can have any number of problems, so it's very important to check this. Now, normal brake pedal operation, if we just do a normal brake pedal apply, let up, brake pedal apply, let up, again, this is a normal working switch, but it's important to keep in mind you still want to verify that the switch is working properly before you continue with your diagnosis. These switches you're not necessarily going to see in the data PIDs because CAN bus is only so fast, you will not necessarily be able to see if there's a glitch. Now, if scan tools were as fast as real life data like a scope is, maybe we'd be able to catch glitches. And if the glitch is severe enough, you might catch that. Maybe you step on the brake pedal and it changes from on off momentarily even while you're holding the pedal. That would be an obvious glitch, which you could easily pick out and call a switch problem after you verify power and ground to the switch. So anyhow, that's what we did to verify that the switch was working correctly. We can see that if we hit the switch repeatedly again here, everything's looking normal. The switch is working opposite like it's supposed to. So we're good with the switch. We're going to go ahead and proceed back to the scan tool side of the diagnosis here so that you can see where we went from here and how we resolved the problem.
Okay, so you saw the scope video, and obviously we had a normally operating switch, so we can cross that off our list. But I did want to show you a waveform, not only from this vehicle, but in comparison to a faulted vehicle that had a bad switch, just so you can see the difference in waveforms. It is helpful to see that in most cases. So we can see this is the normal switch. The two switches are basically mirroring each other, just like they were in the scope pattern. Now we will move and look to a defective switch. So this is actually on a different vehicle. This is a Hyundai. The switch works the same. So it's one side of the switch goes high while the other side of the switch goes low, basically working opposite of each other. And you can see on the left-hand side, it's working normally and everything looks pretty okay. And then as you go to the far right side of the capture, you can see where there is dropouts and hash and things are not functioning like they should be. So this is generally what you're gonna see when you see faulting. I do encourage you to kind of bang on the brake pedal a little bit with your foot, you know, kind of hammer it a little bit to see if you can get it to act up. Sometimes when you have an intermittent problem like this, a little bit of forcefulness with the switch will reveal this kind of a glitch or problem. You know, you can also reveal these glitches if maybe there's an issue with the connection by jiggling the connections or wiring harness. So anyhow, just wanted to show that before we proceed further so you could see what a bad one looks like. A really bad one, I should say, on a vehicle here. So, okay, so we've verified that the switches work. We can see that the input signal going to the ECM works. We verified that brake light switch was working normally, pretty much chopped off all the branches on our tree here, if we will, without really going a whole lot further. So we've crossed everything off. Really what we've got left at this point is we're trying to figure out why when we press that cruise control enable switch and the ECM is seeing it and acknowledging it, how is that not turning on the cruise control request enabled on the cluster? That's what we need to find out. And really, there's only one way to find that out. We need to figure out how the message gets there, right? So we're gonna look at a bus diagram. So when we look at a bus diagram, this is in the self-study program, and these are helpful for conceptual stuff, but not necessarily precise and accurate for each individual vehicle. It can vary from vehicle to vehicle, so you wanna make sure you look at the vehicle-specific wiring. Because in this diagram here, we're seeing J623, the ECM, towards the top left there, and J285, which is the cluster, are allegedly on the same bus line. We also see that J519 is on that same bus line. So, at least in theory, there should be no reason, if everything is normal, that that message should not be getting to the cluster, which might have led to us thinking, bad cluster, right? Because the cluster not sending the message back, hey, I've turned on cruise control enable request message on the cluster, is in turn inhibiting cruise from functioning. Because again, when we have modules and there's multiple modules involved in making a process work, we need to verify that the messages that go in both directions are working, right? So just because we see the switch is working and the ECM, who's technically in control of ultimate cruise functionality, is there, it may also be looking for that callback signal or response from the cluster saying, yes, I'm displaying the message that cruise control enable request is present. And thus, if it doesn't see that message coming back, perhaps it's going to also prevent cruise. So using that logic, we'll look at the vehicle specific wiring diagram. So in this diagram here, we can see J519 at the very top. We also see J533. That is the gateway module. It's internal to J519, which is the BCM or central electronics module on this vehicle in this specific application. So again, you always want to check all the specific vehicle wiring diagrams before you make any judgment calls of any kind here. So what we want to do now is figure out, okay, how does the cluster and the ECM interact with J519? Are they all on one bus line or not, right? So we'll go through the diagrams here, and I'm just going to skip over here until we get to the diagram. So J623 is in the top left here. We can see they're all wired on this one bus line, high and low, towards the top with the little dots, and we've got orange and black and orange and brown. So we're going to go backwards because we're on page 74/8 in the top right there. We're going to go backwards. We're going to look through the diagram. So we're going to check each one of these diagrams. We'll go both directions just to be 100% sure here. So we don't see no instrument cluster on this one, no instrument cluster on this one, no instrument cluster on this one. We can see the lines then terminate here and they go to connections 24 and 25 on the right side of the screen there. So far right, 24 and 25 under 69 and 70 on the very bottom of the track wiring diagram. So 24 and 25, we're gonna keep going back on the diagrams here until we get to the BCM again. Whoops, went too far. So 24 and 25, we can see the colors are still the same. So we have orange-black and we have orange-brown coming in on T73B 19 and 18 for pins. So we can see that's a dedicated bus line. Now remember, the ECM was on that line. The cluster was not. We see the cluster actually has its own dedicated network right here from J519, the BCM, to the cluster J285. So what does this tell us? This tells us that that message of cruise control enable switch has to travel via the CAM network from the ECM into J519 and back out to the cluster. Then the cluster has to respond and say, yes, I've enabled that on the cluster and show that display. And it has to send that message back through J519 and all the way back to the ECM. So what are we going to do next? We'll skip to the next page. The first thing I did was I like to look at things as, let's look at both ends. And then if we check both ends and we're normal on one end and not normal on the other end, and nothing is wrong on this end as far as the module goes, then we need to look at what's in between, right? So I went to the cluster. I wanted to check the coding. You can see anytime when you're on the TOPDON Pro Series tools, you'll get a screen like this when you first enter into a module. You can take a screen capture of this or take a picture with your phone. Always a good idea if you're going to do anything related to coding or programming, because this way you have this information. So if something doesn't go quite right, you can restore the module back to what it was. So we see long coding towards the bottom here is 270A01. Now, long coding is usually what tells the module what specific options it has and also tells it, you know, which wires to turn on and off based on the equipment level of the vehicle. So I went into the coding. I checked things. The coding was right. Nothing was messed up on the cluster. So I decided to look in live data. And in live data, you can actually see and verify communication status with the central electronics. It actually had communication status for pretty much everything. So you could find out, is the cluster actually receiving messages from each of the modules? So in this particular case, the answer is yes. It's receiving module communications from the central electronics. I did check. It was also receiving communication from the engine control module and all other modules. They all read active. Everything looked normal. There was no reason to believe that the cluster was malfunctioning. All other functions, especially functions where like you press the other switches on the steering wheel and it controls things on the cluster, all of those were working normally too. So again, we had absolutely no other symptoms or concerns that would suggest that we had a problem with the instrument cluster. So now what? Now we know that J519 is in between. So I decided I was going to try something and just see what happened. This is something you can experiment with if you run into an anomalous issue on a vehicle. Sometimes this will fix a weird, bizarre issue for which you can't find other explanations. So I went into the central electronics module, and I decided I would look at the coding there. Now look at the long coding on this. This is hexadecimal coding. There are more digits there than I care to count. And every one of those two-digit blocks represents some kind of an option that can be turned on and off selectively within the module. So that's absolutely crucial that you remember that, because again, if this gets screwed up in any way, functionality could change, things could potentially not work correctly. So this was the avenue I wanted to look at next. So when you go into the long coding menu on Volkswagen and on a TOPDON Professional Series tool, you will get a screen like this. So this is actually a long coding helper. Now, you can also do this via the internet. There is an online coding feature that will automatically attempt to download the proper coding for the module. But if you go into the long coding helper, it can be insightful. Now, again, you always want to record the initial code before you touch anything, which we showed you on the last screen. But here, you can go through each of these data blocks in the coding and determine if there is something that could be switched on or off depending on the vehicle level of equipment. So that's exactly what I did. I went in and I found that on block 17, where you see highlighted there, cruise control system is an option that can be selectively turned on or off. Now you'll notice that that bit has been checked. So the coding is correct for this vehicle. So there's no reason whatsoever that we should be suspicious of J519 being coded incorrectly. So there's really no reason we can see in the coding that is potentially screwing up this communication. However, there are some weird things that happen with modules sometimes. Modules can have bizarre logic locks. Coding can get corrupted and it may not be readily apparent. Programming, same kind of thing. There are weird things like this that can happen. So, me being someone who likes to try things, I thought maybe we should try recoding this module. Even if we just enter in the exact same coding, let's see if that potentially resets something that is not working correctly, right?
Okay, so we're going to continue on with the diagnosis now. So we verified that the switch wasn't really doing anything anomalous. We did not see anything smoking gun that was showing us that the switch was the problem. So what we're going to do now is we're going to go into the body control module. Now again, what we found here was the switch position was reading out in the ECM correctly. The switch positions were obviously being received from the steering control module or steering module where the switches are located up here. Excuse me, it's not a module, it's just switches. But anyhow, the signals were being received from there, getting all the way to the ECM. We know that was working. The other thing that we do know is that the BCM or J519 is absolutely involved in this overall process. And we know that, number one, because we have the brake switch, which is wired to both, for two different reasons, obviously. It's wired to the J519 to control brake lamp output, but it also is aware of the switch positions as far as cruise and everything else, because it's on the network and it's in the function chain. So what we're going to do is we're going to see, okay, we had no fault codes, we had a switch that was working normally, didn't see anything anomalous there. So we've got nothing that should be inhibiting the cruise control function. So the next thought that I had about the diagnosis was, what's the one module that I can't see what's going on with the switch positions, and I'm not really sure if I can confirm if something is working or not working? And that's the BCM, or J519, also known as the Central Electronics Control Module. So my thought was, I'm going to go ahead and see if maybe the coding of this module got screwed up. Maybe for some reason it thinks that this vehicle doesn't have cruise control. I have no idea why this would have happened. I've seen weird electrical problems like this on Volkswagen before. So I thought, the hell with it. Let's try recoding the module and see what happens. So I went in, and on the TOPDON Pro Series tools, most of them do have the online functionality where you can do this. So what I would usually go is go back to the topology screen and go to online functions, and I would go to online coding in the top left corner. So you do need to be connected to the internet. It's going to download some coding files. Then we're going to go single system mode. And then we're going to go down to group 17. Nope, sorry, not 17. 9. Central Electronics. So we're going to click it. It's going to download the file. Now you can see what all the different codes are. Now you'll notice that these are insanely long codes. So these are what they call long coding or hexadecimal coding. These data PIDs are extremely long. And if you don't write them down before you've touched the vehicle, and for any reason the battery goes dead and it loses its coding, you're going to be in a lot of trouble if you don't have a tool like this. Now, with the TOPDON Pro Series tools, if I'm not mistaken, all of them have this functionality, and you can use this by connecting to the internet, doing the online coding function, and it will pull all the list of possible codes. So if you don't know which one it is, you can try each of the possible codes and then check vehicle functionality to make sure it's doing what it's supposed to do. Typically, if your coding is incorrect, it will set fault codes because the module will be looking for specific functions and it will not be seeing those functions happening, and thus it will say, hey, something's wrong here. I'm supposed to be seeing this on this wire and I'm not, or I'm seeing something on a wire I'm not supposed to be. So typically speaking, if you code it wrong, you'll have some obvious signs that it's coded wrong. So what I did from this point was I decided to go ahead and recode the module. So I said, obtain factory code. Usually you can check and it'll try to pull it from the database. We'll give it a moment here.
Okay, so it successfully downloaded the file. You can see that it reads out the correct code. It knows what the code is supposed to be. Now we can tell it to perform it. And the coding has been successfully carried out. So now we know. We also have it backed up. The tool backs it up, which is pretty awesome. Now it's telling us the recommended code. Now if you look through these with a fine-tooth comb, you can verify if they are in fact the same, which I did, and they are. But now, because we connected to the internet and went to the server, we can see that we have the correct code. It pulled the correct code for the vehicle. We recoded the module. I went to check the cruise control functionality. And of course, now the switch works as it should. We see the display on the steering or on the dash cluster. It shows us when we turn off and on the cruise control that it does acknowledge and show the little emblem that indicates the cruise is enabled. And we can set the speed and everything works as normal again. So again, I cannot entirely explain why recoding was what fixed this car. Somebody smarter than me might be able to explain that. I can tell you that sometimes with a lot of modules these days, weird things with software will happen. I don't know if it's something written internally to the module, maybe corrupted data of some sort, some kind of spike in voltage from whatever condition it might be. Maybe you hit a really nasty pothole and the module gets a voltage spike. Who knows what it is? But regardless of that circumstance, sometimes recoding or reprogramming a module will fix anomalous issues where there is no other apparent root cause that you can see. So just something that I wanted to share from an experience standpoint that I think would be beneficial for technicians to know. Again, the TOPDON Pro Series tools, but especially the Max, have a lot of features that you will not have access to. Now you'll notice we also just checked it for fault codes and there were no faults after the coding. So we know that it coded it correctly because otherwise we would have fault codes set. So again, something that you do have access to specifically with the TOPDON Phoenix Max is that online function menu. Again, most of the Pro Series tools have some of this, if not all of it in many situations, but very helpful bailing you out on Volkswagen or Audi. If you do want to try recoding or reprogramming a module, frequently that data will be available through the server connected to the tool through the internet. So really a huge advantage here. And frankly, it just made it easier for me to diagnose the car. It was something I could try at my fingertips. I didn't have to go get the factory tool to do it or anything like that. Just very straightforward and simple for me. And again, it resolved the problem with the cruise control. So really a nice thing. But you can see the advantages of the Max, especially with having that lab scope. We could go physically check and see what was happening with the switch and see if there were any abnormalities happening. Now, any abnormalities you do see, if you see any frequent repeating abnormalities, you would want to put a switch in this. And the reason for that being is, just because it's not throwing a fault code doesn't mean that there's not a failure taking place or imminently coming. So it's important to keep that in mind because you will see intermittent failures on switches electronically that could then lead to inhibition of this stuff. Again, it should set a fault code, but is it going to set a fault code in 100% of circumstances? Not in my experience. So something to keep in mind for future reference, just if you're working on any vehicles, especially with a brake pedal position switch, and you're having any cruise or throttle related functionality issues, make sure you're going down to that switch and verifying that the switch is working and that you don't see any anomalous dropouts or spikes in the signal. And again, you want to look at both legs of the signal because the vast majority of brake switches are going to have that redundancy with two legs, and each leg is responsible for demonstrating to a module that there's a redundancy of functionality. This side's working normally, this side's working normally. If the module sees that one side's not working normally, you may still have functionality, but it could also flag a fault code or disable functionality. If both sides are faulting, then you know you should absolutely have a fault code, and you definitely should lose functionality on things like throttle and cruise control. So just some things to keep in mind. Again, this is going to be a general application, the switch discussion that we had here on many vehicles. So if you got questions about this video, you have questions about the Phoenix Max, anything like that that you just want to share, questions about my diagnostic process, anything I can do to help or try to elaborate on or explain better, let me know. You know, I'll try to help you if I can, and hopefully I can give you better answers if maybe I missed something here in the video. But anyway, this is Shotgun Diagnostics, and I greatly appreciate you watching the video.